residents inside were able to make it out just in time. Firefighters arriving here and also able to contain this fire before it spread.
Brothers and sisters, welcome back to Beyond the Shield. Today's guest is Tim Kaye. Tim Kaye is a retired fire lieutenant from the City of Milwaukee Fire Department and is currently the operations manager at Conway Shield. I've been asked several times by our listeners to get more in depth into what Conway Shield is and exactly what we do here in this building, not only in this studio, but in the building that's below me. So I decided to bring Tim in. We're going to get a little background history of who he was, where he came from, give him a little street cred, and then we're going to jump into what he does here and how we can make your shields better on what we do here and what you give us. So with that being said, Tim, welcome to the show.
Thanks, Paul. What a pleasure to be here. Absolutely awesome. Yeah, I'm psyched.
What he's really telling you is it gives him about an hour. He doesn't have to be on the production floor. He can come up here and hang out in the studio with me.
Well, that's true. I do nothing of value, and I try to take a nap every chance I get around here.
Awesome. So, Tim, why don't you give me a little background. Tell me how you got here. Let's talk about your younger years, and then basically how you went from, growing up as a kid and then how you ended up here. We're going to kind of take your whole career and shorten her down to a quick 15 minutes and kind of get an idea of who you are as an individual and as you just said, the value you bring to Conway Shield, because you truly do understand it. You've been in the street, not only in firefighting, but also in law enforcement. So you really have both sides of the coin covered here, and I think that it really makes a big difference in the effect that you bring into Conway Shield. So give us a little rundown of who Tim Kaye is.
Huh, Tim Kaye, there's something. I was born on the south side of Milwaukee, and in the neighborhood I grew up with, it seemed like everybody there was firemen and police officers. And my dad, he retired from the City of Milwaukee Police Department. He had 32 years there. And just growing up with him and the stories and the love and passion that he had for his job, although he always said the only smart cop is a fireman, because there's a lot of police officers that after a short amount of time working for any city, you know, they see that there's something better on the other side, Team Red. But growing up on the south side, lived with mom, dad, I had an older sister, Lisa, and I had a great childhood, a lot of kids, and the people I hung out with were cops and firefighters' kids. And most of them all worked for the City of Milwaukee, and we always had a lot of interaction at their homes. And I really, really enjoyed listening to all the different stories that these police officers and these firefighters had about things that went on at work. And it wasn't always about the greatest bar burner, or the next time they pulled a couple of lines, or, you know, the next perp that they got. And I grew up with some great kids whose parents were in protective services. And that's how I kind of grew up and kind of molded me to who I am today. The sports that I played were usually coached by police and firefighters. They're kids, police and firefighters. I have to say that I really, really enjoyed being around those kinds of people. I felt at home. The visiting of the firehouses. We were there to see my buddy's dad sitting out front, watching traffic, talking to the community, paying, you know, a quarter or 50 cents into the tin can in the refrigerator, grab a soda or so, and just hearing about the day-to-day things that happen in the world of firefighters and police officers. And during school, loved school, but when I got to high school, I was a good student. I probably could have been way better, as you hear about other firefighters. Something about school. Yeah, you're smart, but you really didn't apply yourself. And there was something else out there that I loved, and that was this dream of being a firefighter one day. Not a police officer, you know. Or my dad talking about the police department, absolutely awesome. Awesome stories. He loved it. Had a great group of friends, and he played for the softball team. And he had his gang of people, like as firefighters have their gang of friends around the firehouse. And but the one thing that always kind of drew me in was I liked the big fire truck. I liked everything about it. I loved that the heavy equipment operators, the mechanicalness of it. You know, now that there's a lot of electronics, but at the time, you know, wheels and levers. And there was just something about firefighting that drew me in. And it was, I found myself talking to more firefighters about how they got started and what they felt. And one of the common things that I ran into is that school part where I loved, you know, my parents sent me to Thomas More College Preparatory School of Young Men. Not that they wasted their money, but school kind of really wasn't my thing. And it seems to be a trend with firefighters. There's something different. School wasn't their thing, but there was something else out there. And the older I got, the more I got interested and was just driven for firefighting. And after I graduated high school, I got hired by Greendale Fire Department as a paid on call. Greendale Fire's a small suburb in Milwaukee County, and I got banged out on a few jobs with my big pager that I responded to in my car with a light. But I went to Milwaukee Area Technical College, and I got an associate degree in fire science. And it was right around 89 or 90, I applied for Milwaukee Fire Department. And I actually did get hired end of 91. And I was invited to a class, and then my class got canceled. They tabled the list that I was on because of there was something going on in the courts, whatever the fight was at the time. You know. They tabled the list, and I remember coming home from wherever and running into my dad, and I said, this is what happened. I got a letter today from the Police and Fire Commission, and they were taking on, I think, guys from West Milwaukee. We had some type of contract going on with West Milwaukee, and they had to bring in 22, and they had to vacate another 22, and I was one of those. And there was another gentleman from New Berlin that happened to, too, and we ended up becoming good friends later on. But I remember telling my dad this story, you know, about this happening, and he goes, hey, at roll call today, I heard that the sheriff's department is hiring. And I'm like, sheriff's department? What? No, I want to lay lines, man. I want to do interior firefighting. And I remember him saying how hard it is, and knowing how hard it is to apply and actually get hired by a fire department.
Which is so funny because it, you know, we look at today and it seems like you can shop around if you want a career as a firefighter. And back in the day, it was really difficult. It was really hard to get on the job.
I think Milwaukee had, I don't know, 4,000 or 5,000, 6,000 people applying at the time. And so I was just broken inside when I got that letter that I wasn't going to be in that class. So my dad mentioned the sheriff's department. And this wasn't something that I wanted to do. But he says, hey, maybe in the meantime, before you apply somewhere else, maybe this is a path for you.
Yeah, maybe you need a job, kid.
Yeah, exactly. Start. Maybe he's trying to get me out of the house, is my guess. You know, beat it, all your food. So I did apply, and I ended up getting hired in the first class and met a great group of guys. And a lot
of those people became firefighters, by the way. So it's kind of funny that most of the people, even the sheriff's department that you worked with, became firefighters of the city.
And you know who they are, because yes, a lot of them went to Milwaukee, and there had to be at least 9, 10, 11, 12 guys that left.
Yep.
But I came out of the Sheriff's Academy, and I was, I turned 21. They gave me a gun and a badge, and they assigned me to detention. So I went to the jail, and I was assigned to an area of the jail that had Dahmer and Jesse Anderson and Ben Franklin. Those were the guys that I got to watch temporarily, because I worked that position probably just about a year. And during that whole time, I was also applying for other fire departments. I ended up getting hired by the City of Kenosha Fire Department. And there was another gentleman that I got hired there with, Jim Shoopy. And Jim Shoopy was a New Berlin fireman. And he was in that same class of mine that the 22
got. Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah. Huh. And that's how I met Jim Shoopy. Because the same situation happened to him. We would have been hired, and I think it was the end of 91.
Wow, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Yeah. For our listeners, Jim was a very close friend of mine in the volunteers for years, so it's kind of weird how that all came full circle, but I didn't know that.
Yeah, Jim Shoopy. Love that guy. So we went through their academy together. Us, it was us and two other gentlemen, so our class had four, but I loved it. I was there for 5 or 6 years, but there was something missing. There was definitely something missing there. Love the city and love the people, and it's a great little town.
Yeah, Kenosha is a good job to work for.
Oh my gosh.
I mean, they get their work. They're
we got some work, absolutely. Yeah. Learned a lot, had some good bosses, ran with some good firefighters, great partners on the rig. And my friends that I grew up with, whose fathers and uncles and you know, that were Milwaukee firefighters, were like, dude, what are you doing? You know, you love Milwaukee. And I was just so, not angry, but very disappointed on how that whole situation played out earlier. You know, my first introduction to Milwaukee Fire Department was, oh, sorry, kid. Yeah, this list, yeah. How hard it is to get hired? You're out. Well, that kind of didn't sit well with me. But it was some good friends that said, Tim, apply. Come back. Come back to Bruce City. And that's what I did. I applied, got hired, and no regrets. And it was probably the best thing for me because the people that I met and the amount of work that we got and the connection, the brotherhood, the bonding, this was something that it's hard to explain unless you experience it. Because my first day on the job, we were end of tour, probably had an hour left. Guys are drinking coffee. I'm still packaging all my junk up and my gear up. And this large man, Jim Youngblood, he's about 375 pounds and 6'8". And he was a big truck 12 guy, just a monster. And he says to me, Tim, what are you doing today on your off? I said, I don't know, probably going to drink beer, hang out, whatever. And he goes, yeah, you're going to be coming with us today. And we're laying concrete. I'm like, okay. And that was the first time that I got to hang out with my crew after one day. And we busted up, I think, a driveway or a porch and looked like a patio or something. I can't remember at all, but we busted butt. And it was the entire crew was there. And we drank beer and had steaks on the grill. And it was awesome. The things that you learn from other firefighters, the talents that they have is absolutely incredible. The things that they do on their offs. And because of this job, working for Milwaukee and working with some of the greatest guys, I've been blessed and very fortunate to work with the good guys. You know, you go through... Every firefighter, everybody has their different skill sets, but there's some that they're just like, they make the Hollywood A-list. You know these people, who they are. And for some reason, I was fortunate to work with many of these guys. And I learned most of, windows, demolition, roofing, gutters, concrete, plumbing, electrical. Some code, some not, but it's incredible that the different skill sets that these guys have and that I have now to pass on to my kids or to other people. being a firefighter for Milwaukee was, there's really no words other than I was blessed, for sure.
Listening to Beyond the Shield can enhance your performance by providing you valuable knowledge. When you shop at ConwayShield.com, you will find the tools you need to improve your performance. Conway Shield has a strong reputation for delivering the reliable, top-of-the-line gear to firefighters and law enforcement professionals. Visit our website through the link in the video description to explore our extensive equipment selection and discover why we are the trusted choice for professionals. Conway Shield, we protect courage. Now back to the podcast. So, you mentioned something earlier that I want to circle back on, and that's that you said there was something different about the parents of the kids you grew up with, and your father included, because they were in civil service than other people. What do you think that difference was? Huh. What do you think made them, what made them different? What made you drawn to the type of individuals they were?
One, accountability. If that kid screwed up, you heard about it, and then they move forward with it. And it just seemed, when you look at younger kids, you'll see the ones that shy away from everybody. You'll see the ones that are quiet, won't make eye contact type of things. And then you have the children of firefighters and police officers. And you could have a little child talk to an adult in a awesome conversation, have a conversation. They feel relaxed. And the parents, I had to be home at 5. And if I wasn't home at 5, I'd hear a whistle. My dad had this tongue and finger. I still haven't mastered it. I can't even come close to doing it. But when you heard it, neighbors would open their door. Timmy, your dad's calling. You better get home. So it's like, oh, come on. But there was this, there was a plan for you every day. We had to wake up early. You had your chores in the morning. Whether it was dishes or vacuuming, you had something assigned to you. Kind of like the firehouse, which is weird. You show up, maybe you have your coffee for a bit in the morning, but everybody has a detail, whether it's stirring the toilet or vacuuming or cleaning up around the firehouse. The same thing was at home with these kids. They always had to do something, be part of something, be a team of somebody, something to someone. And their parents had them, whether it was putting your bike away. A lot of kids would come home, drop their bike or put the kickstand up, and it's outside, and they would leave it. Not at a cop or firefighter's house. You better put your bike away, and you better take care of that bike because, mom or dad had to bust their butt in order to pay for this. Treat it as it's important to you. And things like that. I remember building a shed for my neighbor. His dad wanted to put us all to work, another fireman. And we built a shed or a pool or all the things. It was being part of something. And it wasn't just a bunch of kids randomly running around the neighborhood and causing grief for the neighbors. It was some good kids around that block. And I'm in my head, I can picture all the different houses on South 24th Street, from Dennis, Parnell, Birchwood, so many police officers and so many firefighters. I had so many friends growing up. It was ridiculous, but it was all in protective services. And I know today that my kids, I got three boys, and while they're growing up, I heard about them. Like, wow, those kids are well-behaved. Wow, they can talk to me like an adult. And I think that is something that is learned by watching their parents over time. No forced hugs, no forced conversations. It was something that they want to do. And growing up with these boys, and they would be at the firehouse. Having them at the firehouse when I was still working, reminded me of hanging out with my buddies, hanging out where their dads are working at the firehouse. And it's like this cycle is just happening over and over and over again. And two of my boys are actually interested in firefighting. And I have nothing to say about that other than that's awesome. Awesome for them. One is finishing up college. My oldest boy, he was in St. Louis. He just finished up his master's in, oh my gosh, bioinformatics, data analyst, something or another, things that I can't even pronounce. So he chose a different path. But my two younger boys, I have a 21 and a will be 17, are interested in the fire service.
In the career. Awesome. So it really was accountability and responsibility of becoming a team, or like I always say it, they were instilled in them a belief in the greater good. There was something more than just themselves. It was more to life than themselves. It wasn't them first. It was family, team, whatever. I mean, to assist and help in the outside. It wasn't just me. It's not all about me. It's about they were raised with a belief that there's something bigger than you, and get over it. Tough luck, you know. That's. I mean, that's excellent. That's because I, you know, you seemed, convicted on it, and I just wanted to get an idea of what was it that drew them to you, you know, that drew you to them. So, come on a job. I think you went to 30s.
Yeah, I came on to 30s. Yeah, real busy engine company. And I'd get to work again, blessed with the people that I worked with. There's great firefighters all over the city. But at that, well, I think wherever anybody is assigned when they come on, it seems to be the best place in the world, right? That's the best place in the universe for you. But I truly believe that I was blessed being there. Engine 30 and sister company Truck 12. I mean, and it was at a time where we were getting work.
Yeah, they're good. They're good companies. Both of those are very, very busy companies. They're well respected within the fire department. I mean, they're known for getting the job done, without a doubt.
And I had a mixed bag of fellows, and I remember walking in the door. I was welcomed. I think I got hosed down with one of their inch and a halfs. Say welcome, and we went right to a fire, and we came back, and I. It's like you're trying to prove yourself to your company. And, well, we did a great job. I think we had three fires that day, bunch of EMS runs, and I was introduced to multiple shootings and multiple patients down in the street, and then picking up from there, going to a working fire. And I was just thrown to the fire right away. And my first day was like, this, I'm in the right place. I love this. It gave you purpose, and I think I earned the respect of the guys. I think anybody earns the respect of their crew when you're that busy. They get to see you and what you're capable of doing right away. Whether you're laying lines and going in, or if you're laddering and going through windows and grabbing kids, roof operations, how you operate there as a team. I mean, being busy, again, I was fortunate to be assigned there with some of the best guys that I still talk with today. Just awesome, awesome human beings.
Yeah, it definitely, it speeds up the learning curve, but it also, being a busy company speeds up that learning curve real quick. And it also speeds up the ability for you to, like you said, prove yourself to a company because you're getting the work. There's no waiting around. It comes to you right away, and you're either going to make it or not. You're either going to show that you're trained and you know how to do what you have to do, or it's going to show that maybe you should have found a different career. I mean, that's for sure. So obviously you spent some time as a firefighter. How long were you a firefighter before you became a lieutenant?
I think it was, had to be six or seven years, because I came on at 30s. I worked there for a couple of years, and I was a hazmat technician on the city of Kenosha Fire. And so I had all the state certs and Fed stuff and all the other crap that comes with it. And I was asked to come out to Engine 25. And at the time, that was the hazardous materials house. And there was a vacancy, I think because of a promotion. And they asked me to come out there, and I did. And that was great. It was a whole different skill set that needed to be required. And again, worked with some awesome people that talk about the team concept, you know, whether it was the meters or working in the hot zone or suiting up in level A. And I was there probably 3 years. And I left there to take a spot back at 30s because there was an opening there. And I wanted to knock the rust off the pipes, if you will, because I applied for, I took a lieutenant's exam. And I was back at 30s acting because I think my regular boss was acting BC a lot, or he was working at the hazmat house. And so I had an opportunity to act as boss on Engine 30. Year and a half, and got to get a taste of being in that front seat and what really happens there. And that was an experience. And I got promoted.
I mean, so that's actually, it brings up a good point. You had an opportunity to act in that, act out of title is what we call it in the city. You had that opportunity to do that, which I would assume gave you a much better insight to what that position is. I mean, obviously, if you're riding backwards, you get an idea of what it's like to be a boss, but you don't really understand the full complexity of it or the responsibility of it, of being a company officer and being responsible for that vehicle and the four people that ride on it. Tell me, what did you think? Do you think that was beneficial to you stepping into the role of lieutenant? Or, I mean, would you recommend that to people? Or do you feel that it's just, that's what I did and it's no big deal?
It was a huge deal for me. The way you learn, the way you pick up these skills are being thrown right into the position. You have to experience. You can't learn it on a tabletop. They don't write any books that is real. There's no instruction manuals for any of those things. And I had the support of my crew. And that was the thing, as I found out, is I wasn't really in charge of anything. I was responsible for the guys on the rig. Because those guys could make you look like a superstar, or they could actually absolutely destroy you and embarrass you in front of the command staff on a scene of whatever.
Absolutely.
I learned real quickly that, I'm responsible for this company. But the guys that I worked with, absolutely fabulous. And I think back of all the fires and things that just didn't make sense, and pulling up on a hot summer day and having smoke, on the streets, not even knowing where the fire is to some of these buildings because there was so much smoke, and having someone lost on your company, maydays, greater alarms. I was thrown right into it and real quick, and I embraced it. And Milwaukee is huge on, I would say, developing their officers, because during and after a fire scene, there'll be other bosses and command staff that will talk to you, whether it's good or they're going to give you some instruction on to how to change this for next time. And I was fortunate to have great battalion chiefs assigned to my battalion and the surrounding battalions that they were a huge part of my development as a boss, because I had just a great rapport with so many guys that there are no, there's some, not many, but there's some that they don't want to tell you anything about what they're doing. They would keep the secrets, if you will. I was fortunate to work with guys that they give you everything. They'll tell you why this happened or how to change it next time. Every boss has someone that they can talk to in confidence that I could call like, hey, man, this sounds really screwed up. What do you think about this? And these questions or your challenges will never be exposed. They'll never tell anybody about it. It's a private conversation that they're trying to better you, making the job a better place. Because old guys will leave, which I say out with the dinosaurs, you know, and then bring in the new guys. And there is a lot of guys and gals that will, they feel that they have to, not because they have to, because they want to develop the younger officers, because they're going to be the future of the department.
So you're advocating, you're a strong advocate to have a coach.
Absolutely. Coaching, you know what? I would say most great officers are coaches, for sure. Good listeners, but yeah, you're a good coach. You're going to do very well, at least in the fire service, for sure. Appreciate who you work with. Oh, my gosh. Yeah. I would try to grasp, if you had an opportunity presented to you of a different opportunity, whether it's an acting boss or going out to the hazmat house or working on a rescue company or, you know, working for heavy urban rescue, there was so many different specialty skill sets that are offered by Milwaukee Fire Department that everybody had a place to go if you wanted to. You could go through your entire career as a firefighter and not be part of a special team, and that's great. But there is a lot out there. I was on the hazmat team, loved it. Another opportunity that I had, I was sent to headquarters. And I was one of the bosses on the Milwaukee fireboat. I didn't know what the heck was going on there. I'm a big boater, but I got thrown right into it and absolutely loved it. Being part of that Marine division was neat, something different. And I understood what happens on the water and how they can support land operations with City of Milwaukee rivers with water support to high-rise fires. Pretty neat stuff out there. But there's a lot of opportunity. Heck, community service, getting out there in the community. The recruitment division. I mean, there are so many things out there. Everybody has, there's a spot for everybody. And, just thinking back about missed opportunities, you know. I loved hazmat, but then, because it was offered to me early, but there was something about me that I always wanted to be part of the heavy urban rescue team. Something about that, the mechanicalness of everything, the whole operation, working as a team again, and knowing these guys, wow, another awesome group of guys, beautiful special team. And so I wish I was part of that. Fire Academy. I wanted to be an instructor at the Fire Academy for years. But because of kids, there was no way I could give 100% of myself and to commit to Monday through Friday kind of schedule. And I was already working. So my wife was a school teacher for MPS. She's retired. She would work her Monday through Friday. Firefighter schedule, you're on 24 off 48. Well, because of the trades that we had the ability to make, I was working a on two off five schedule for 5 years, actually more than that, where I'd work Saturday, Sunday, off Monday through Friday. So my weekends were pizza and brunch. the firehouse pizzas on Saturday night and brunch on Sunday mornings. That's what I did. Pizza and brunch diet.
Pizza and brunch.
I'm thinking it was more than 5 years.
I remember asking one day when I was quartered with you that you asked the cook if we could not have brunch.
And I think you actually cooked a couple of those meals because of that situation.
Could be.
Yeah, that was, yeah. Oh, gosh, Engine 5. That was another great place to work.
So as I understand it, really what you're recommending to any firefighters that are new to the job, not necessarily young in age, but new to the job, is embrace the opportunity or the opportunities that are put in front of you, that learn as much, pick up as much knowledge as you can, gain as much knowledge as you can, go over to, a friend of ours who's in LA County has said the same thing, that LA County was so big that he could go to the Marine Division. He could go to the Air Division. He could go to the Wildland Division. He could do all these other things. And each one that he picked up knowledge and information and had personal growth. So I'm to understand from you that you would recommend to our listeners that to expand your world, go outside your comfort zone, and continue to have personal growth by gaining new knowledge from all these opportunities that the fire department awards you, instead of just choosing to, I have the job, I can now sit in my recliner and just kick back and wait for 30 years to pass.
Absolutely. Yeah, the opportunities, it seems like they're, at least my experience with Milwaukee Fire, and I'm sure other departments are the same thing, or you do have these opportunities, but then you feel comfortable. You come on the job, you're nervous. I was fortunate to be on a busy company, start earning the respect of your crew and your battalion, and then you're one of the trusted members when you get off the rig, and the battalion chief is looking for certain companies, like, we're going to need something over here. You guys, I want you to take care of this. And I was part of many companies that were like that. The friendly faces that show up for a full assignment. But that if you feel comfortable early on, it's time to do something different. You work a couple of years and you feel comfortable at what you're doing, that's one thing. Start pulling in some new stuff. Because by the time you have 20 plus years on, and just a Rolodex spinning of all the different opportunities that I had, the fires that I was in, the death that we saw, the good times, the bad times. I don't know if a lot of people know what a Rolodex is. Now that I just think about it.
I say slide deck, so I'm sure they ask the same thing. Slide deck. What the heck's a slide deck? Yeah.
So I'm going through all these different things in my career and with different departments and gosh, if I wouldn't have grabbed those opportunities, I think I probably would. You would have to be a different person, I would think, because you can't stop learning. Because if you have that drive and passion about something, which I loved being a firefighter, absolutely. And the thing about it is you, are you a firefighter forever? No, I'm not laying lines. I'm not doing roof ops. I'm not doing interior tax. But the thing that still remains with everybody after retirement is you have purpose and you take away all those life experiences and all the firehouse talk. Like the kitchen table. Everybody talks about this kitchen table thing. Yeah. Like, what the hell is the kitchen table, right?
Yeah.
In the morning at shift change, Milwaukee started at 8. Everybody usually gets in at 7 o'clock and they're just shooting the shit, having coffee. And there are all these different conversations going on. Everybody's talking at once and everybody's talking louder than the next. And eventually it's like this roar is coming from the kitchen. And when you show up at shift change and you walk through whatever door you come into, you hear it. You hear the roar in the kitchen. And it's like, put your gear on the rig, take your guy down, get yourself ready, make sure the rig's checked out. take a breath and enter the kitchen because here it comes. And I learned so much about things. My first mortgage, guys at the kitchen table, do this, don't do that. Put this down, don't do that, don't do this. You have a home, you have a loan. that will get you in trouble. But kids going off to college, people that have been through kids going off to college, traveling, baseball, hockey, soccer, lacrosse, all these different teams and traveling with that, plumbing problems, who to call for, we had plumbers on the job, electrical work. We got guys, anything that you needed to write a check for or do yourself, I got a lot of information from that kitchen table, from the guys. Whether they screwed up, they would tell you, and they'd get made fun of. But they would tell you maybe this would be the right way. Don't do what I did. Heck, your deferred comp, savings, investment. Kid, you're getting these big checks now for being a young man, and now you're getting paid. What to do with your money and what not to do with your money. Don't live like a rock star. Don't buy a boat. Don't travel. Don't get new cars. Don't get new motorcycles. Wait, that sounds like what I did. Wait. Yep.
Yes.
Yeah. But all that comes from the kitchen table. And that's just that shift change. And then, lunch comes, high noon. Everybody in the fire service eats at noon and 5, and that meal should be out there or there's going to be trouble. And at noon, starts all over again. There is that roar. It starts softly, and then it turns into a roar. And then you have it at 5 o'clock in the evening again. And those things, just talking about it right now, I talking about finances and plumbing or things you need with your home, that all came from the kitchen table. And those all came from firefighters. So, yeah, we're not laying lines, and we're not doing roof operations. But the things that you walk away are the things you get as for being in that room at that time on the department with the companies. You're leaving with all those things. Yeah, you walk out of the firehouse, but you're taking away so much. Lot of horrible things that go with that, and you kind of push that or just push it all the way down. But for the most part, you're leaving with some pretty awesome things. And again, yeah, so you're not laying lines, but you definitely are taking away a little bit of every firefighter that you passed cross with, whether it was good or bad. Me, most of my stuff is good, and I have no complaints, and I truly do feel blessed.
So we're going to wrap up this portion of the podcast and get into the second half. But so I guess I'm going to sum up your career, firefighter in a busy company. You go out to Hazmat, which is a special operations in the city of Milwaukee. You operate there for a while. Come back, acting lieutenant in the same busy company. Find your way to the lieutenant's rank. Spend your career there. You, again, stay in some pretty busy companies. And then you left your last years on the job. You went out to the Milwaukee Fire Academy, to our training academy. And you were an instructor out there, not only with our recruits, but our in-service training, our fire cadets, and pretty much all of our centralized training goes through our Milwaukee Fire Academy. So with that wonderful career, and most of it as a company officer, what is the one piece of advice, as we segue into the next half of this, what is the one piece of advice you would give to young officers to be better at their job? Hmm. Now that you've seen you've had a career of being an officer, what is the one piece you would give them to help them out?
Be humble. Be humble. What I was touching upon earlier, where you are not in charge of a thing. You are responsible for many people and how that operation goes down. Still be a good listener and watch what is going on around you. and really
know your people is what you're getting at. Yeah,
know your people is right, and to think that again, blessed with the companies, and I think back of some of the senior. We talk about that senior man, and it couldn't be more important. That senior man is a firefighter sitting in the back of the rig by choice. And for a young officer to feel that that person, old, has been dinosaurs just waiting for his pension, look around. Those old guys are working at busy companies. Those are the guys that are carrying all the secrets. And they have the things not to do and the things to do. And they can, I would have to say they are probably the most important person on that rig is the senior man, because they have seen the good things and they have seen some shit shows, and those you don't forget. And if you give them the chance to assist with training, whether it's hands-on or just a conversation, those are the guys that will make or break you. And if you want to develop early as a young officer, you watch those guys, whether they're on your crew or another crew, and you take that all in, because they survived this job for learning by some of the wrong things to do. They've seen some things that were horrible, and those are the guys that are the most important part of that team. It's the old guys that are on those busy companies. And I would, one thing, there isn't one.
Well, you really said it. The biggest thing is be humble. Because if you're humble and you're in service to your crew, you know your crew, you're in service to them, you pay attention to that senior person, and you learn from them, really that all comes in to being humble. So really that is the thing you're looking at. It's just plain and simple, be humble. So with that takeaway, we're going to take a quick break. And again, this episode is brought to you by Silencio Coffee, the official coffee of the Conway Shield podcast. Man, Silencio Coffee always hits the spot during long recording sessions. These guys really know their beans. I want to express our sincere gratitude to Silencio Coffee for their ongoing support of Beyond the Shield and gives back to the heroes we serve. You can find them at silenciocoffee.com or in the links below this video. Get a taste of the coffee that's in my cup. All right, we're back from the break. Before we get into your work here at Conway Shield, I would be remiss if I didn't say that you mentioned earlier about what firefighters do on their offs, and I want our listeners to know, you know, several times here, Tim has mentioned the mechanical. I love the mechanical part of it. I love the instruments and the everything else that went with it. So what Tim did on his offs is he built motorcycles that he learned on YouTube, correct?
Yeah, bits and pieces.
Bits and pieces picked up on YouTube.
Knew a few people.
But he literally built custom motorcycles in the day when it was really a big deal. And was very good at it, was a wanted builder, and then decided that he wanted to become an armorer, so turned around and learned how to build firearms, and he built several different firearms. So when I saw that, and he was still working with the fire department, I said, Tim, would you like to become a law enforcement equipment salesman, and you can be our armorer here at Conway Shield, and you can in turn go out and do some law enforcement sales for body armor, firearms, and all of the things that we carry on the LE side. And he said yes. So that was a great opportunity for Conway Shield to expand out into a market that we were fairly new in. That's how Tim came into Conway Shield. And then, and correct me if I'm wrong on the story, but our manager at the time, our production manager at the time, who had been here over 20 years, decided to retire. And I remember getting a phone call, and Tim said, think I could do that job. And I said, well, I know you can do it, Tim, but you understand it's a full-time job. You can't be a fire, a company officer on the Milwaukee Fire Department and be the production manager at Conway Shield. This is not a part-time gig. This is the real deal. You're busy every day. This is, you know, we do a, this is a very busy shop downstairs. And I think within a two-week period, you spoke with my son, James, who runs the company. You guys, he had told you, well, you have to go through an interview process like everybody else. You did. You went, met all the leadership team here that we operate with, and they chose you to be the production manager downstairs. And within 2 weeks, you went from being a lieutenant with the Milwaukee Fire Department assigned to the training school to being the production manager at Conway Shield. And contrary to what he's going to tell you, that all he does is take naps and does nothing useful here, you've really been a huge asset, and oddly enough, we have such a good place here that when people retire from their full-time jobs, they, meaning that, so our production manager retired, our old guy, Paul, and he still works here part-time because he loves working here so much. He just didn't want to have a schedule where he's here every day. So we have the kind of company that when you retire from it, you turn around and come back work part-time because you enjoy it so much. So along comes Tim, and he becomes the production manager and steps into this, much like many times, as you said earlier, in talking about the fire service career, that it kind of went in there somewhat blind, had an understanding, but somewhat blind, and was now pounded with this vast amount of information handed his way regarding how we do business here and how we make things happen, and gobbled it all up, spit it all back out, and is now working, again, as our production manager, just kicking tail downstairs, moving. I'm telling you, we move more shields than I probably ever did. And I know that's because of the teamwork that you built there. So, Tim, let's talk a little bit about the assets you brought from the fire service that you brought here to this company regarding true teamwork, camaraderie, and cohesiveness we would call a small company unit. So tell me what did you bring with you that you dialed in here with a group of people that now they are making, they're pushing more product out the door than we ever have.
So your story was pretty good. that was almost 100% correct. The only thing was, what you left out was, you and I talked. So when I went home after, so what happened was, I came in here one day, I had to do some paperwork for some firearms, and it was during a New Year's weekend, buildings closed, and that's where I saw Paul cleaning out his office, and I was staring at him, and he
Not
finally-
Not me, Paul Stan, our manager.
Oh, yes. Yeah. And he was cleaning out his office, and he didn't even realize that I was standing there. He's like, oh. What are you doing here? I said, what are you doing here? He goes, oh, I'm just cleaning up. And I'm like, it looks like you're cleaning out, man. He goes, yeah, I'm retiring in a couple of weeks. And we ended up sitting and shooting the shit for, man, a couple of hours. And wished him well and all that, and was on my way. And my kids and wife know who Paul Stan is. And I was telling them at home, I think we were throwing something on the grill or whatever, and I say, hey, Paul Stan's retiring. And one of my boys is like, Dad, I know you've been wanting to do something in retirement. What about that? He does all that cool stuff. And I'm like, you know what? Let me give Conway a call. And we talked. And I think 2 hours went by that you and I were talking about it. And you told me about I would have to retire. And then I'm like, I'm all in. I'm in. And you're like, hey, dum-dum, you might want to talk to your wife. This is probably
True
one of
story.
Those decisions that you would probably like to tell her and share this story with her. And so, yes, I have to say, and I talked to my wife and couldn't have been more supportive, because she knew it was time to leave the fire service, but there was something else there for me. There's no way you can retire at, I don't even know what I was, 52 or whatever. Still young. I still got a pulse when I wake up. So I retired right away. It was I put my 2 weeks in after having and I think you guys had somebody already planned on coming in.
We did, yeah.
But
you impressed everybody and they chose you instead.
That worked out great. Cause then 2 weeks later, so I retired January 21st and started here. That was a Friday. I started here on Monday, the 24th. Holy cow. And I've been here about 2.5 years. And so when Paul Stand, the production manager, was retiring, and part of the thing was with him is that if you would have taken me on here, that he would have stuck around and helped me along the way because of the vast amount of information. The CNC work, I can program, I can draw. But there was a lot of things that for the last, 20 some years that he has been putting together as far as the CNC work, whether it's sewing machines, water jets, heck, ordering leather, the logistics department. There is just so much. I was just amazed about the things that are done here at Conway Shield, and it blew me away. And to work with the people that I do, wow. I couldn't, to be welcomed with open arms here, and I knew a lot of the folks that were, not real personally, but I knew them just from being in the building with law enforcement sales and picking up ballistic armor, coming in, coming out, saying hey, hi, and that was about it. But I'm trying to... Everyone here welcomed me with open arms. And again, like a new officer, you show your need that you want to be part of the team and take on as much as you can, learn as much as you can. You listen to those senior people. And there are senior people here. They've been around some anywhere from 15 to 29 years here and been here that long for a reason. And that is because they have that they're driven by pride. The work that they do and some of the stuff that's all hand sewn is just incredible. The skill sets that they have. There are so many talented people here. It's unbelievable. And when we bring some people downstairs into production, they're like, I can't believe all this is here in this building. Yes, we do a lot of stuff from embroidery and leather helmet manufacturing and our shields and my gosh, the anything with the fire service, law enforcement equipment, sales reps from all over, all the different states that they're in. Wow. I'm looking at this team and, again, blessed. Blessed is a word that I keep using because that is truly how I feel, that I could leave something. And I loved the fire service, just did. But this was an opportunity for me that presented itself, just like I mentioned about the fire service. If something feels right for you, hop on it. And I was not comfortable walking in here by any means with the amount of information that is thrown at you and what's expected from you. I had a huge support staff of everybody here. And with that, made it easy. My gosh, I'm looking at all their faces and all the different machines that they work and all the different, the shields. You know, what's neat about being a firefighter and being in here with non-firefighters, I had a story to tell about the shields. What they manufacture here, absolutely awesome. I look at all the, from gold leafs to leather to, gluing, sewing, that it is an art with what they do. But I was able to talk to them about the true meaning of these shields. You know, with every shield, there not only is it traditional, yes, not only does it tell you your rig assignment or whatever, or administrative assignment or any assignment, but there's a story to tell, just like tattoos, right? I had, when I came on, an Engine 30 shield. And with that, there was a story for every black mark, every heater, Bork's lenses that got cooked, a bend in your leather helmet. Each one of those shields tells a story like a tattoo, where you were at the time, what you did with your time there, and then the next shield, where'd you go next? Whether it's a passport system that with a tear off or a new shield and you start. I always liked a new shield. For me, if I got transferred, it would be a fresh, clean piece of leather on my lid. And that was because there was a new story, you know, there was a new story to tell. And I absolutely loved it. When my second assignment was at Engine 25 Hazmat, that started another story, another chapter in my life. I started having kids there. I worked with the chief's driver was assigned there. It was just another story. It was another chapter in your life, just like a tattoo. I remember where I got all these and the reason for all these. They weren't just random things that I put on my body, although it kind of looks very prison-like. But there was a story to tell with every one of these shields. And every day we have a sit-down, and we're always talking with our people here. And there always seems to be another story, whether it's something from the, and not sometimes, but usually it's a firehouse story. There is a story to tell, whether they pull a shield and they say, what does this mean? Well, says the public information officer, you know, this is what PIO is, and this is what they do. And they communicate with the community and work with the news and pass on, you know, real information that the community that the fire department serves wants to hear. And that story could go on for an hour. Jimmy Schein, I love him, Jim Schneider. He retired from Milwaukee Fire, and our paths crossed numerous, numerous times. And after he retired, he came here, he stopped in to say hey, and I happened to walk him around the operation. He's like, oh my gosh, all this is done here at Conway Shield? I'm like, yeah, brother, pretty crazy, hey? And he said, are you hiring anybody? I said, yep. What would you like to do? And he wanted to do like a day or two a week. Well, he works 5 days a week here now because of the love of this job. It shows that there's purpose after the fire service. And he's a legacy kid. Grandfather, dad, brother, nephew, all firefighters. And he's got this huge heritage of firefighting. And he loves each one of the shields. So I had him start to learn the water, cutting the hides, throwing all these hides up there. And we do click a lot of things, using a press to click out the leathers, but we use a water jet a lot, very often. And I watch him sometimes when he is looking at the sales orders. He's looking at the city that they're coming from. And if there's a fire department listed, they are. And then he looks at their shield and it's like he's contemplating or thinking about, you know, where is this going? What is this guy doing? And where is this guy in his career? And he does it a lot, whether it's a big order and the order's huge. We've been getting a lot of huge orders coming through this building, unprecedented. And it is nice to see how the team responds to this big influx of work. The plan changes right away, as with the fire service. Not everything is going to go by the book. You're going to have to make some changes and figure out how to make it better and get it in and get it out. I talked about the kitchen table, and that was something that I missed out of all the things, whether it was laying lines or doing a hard charging interior tack and or roof ops, anything. The thing that I missed when I left, and I didn't think it was going to be a big deal, was the kitchen table, the place where I found out about a lot of things in life and the experiences of young and old about things that happened in their life. Whether it was marriage, the kids going off to college, the food plan that they have to pay for the kids' first year of college, or the food, the rent, mortgages, cars, boats, bikes, you name it. Anything that could come up. Problems with your heating, ventilation, air conditioning, plumbing, roof, windows, concrete, garage door, tires. You found out everything about it. And that I missed. And that's not the only thing. I missed the guys a lot, but the thing I miss the most is the conversation that we had at those kitchen tables around the department. And
so how did we fix that at Conway Shield?
Well, I'll tell you. So one day, so now the Shine's working here. He's retired from Milwaukee Fire. He starts working here, and he's finding that there is a love of another job. And is he firefighting? Nope, not laying lines, but he knows a lot about the fire service, and for him, he loves the idea of knowing where these shields are going, that they're going into the hands of some firefighters around the world, because we're sending these shields, you know, all over the globe, which is so interesting to me, and he loves it. And one day, he says, hey, I'm thinking I'm going to bring a soup in the next day. I'm like, what? Soup? Well, the HEOs in the morning at the firehouse would have refrigerator soup. So whatever the company had the day before and left the leftovers in the fridge, a lot of times the HEO, I had Joey Mack. Joey Mack, awesome HEO. He was our soup guy. And 8 o'clock after the rig is checked and all the morning stuff, he'd get to the kitchen. He'd start covering it. It could be tacos and Cheetos or I don't know, something that's just out of the fridge. And the next thing you know, it's probably one of the best soups you've ever had. And every firehouse did it. And there was all in the cold weather, there was always a soup going. And guys would have it at shift change. Guys would have it, you know, after their morning coffees, during housework. And then the pot would go off. It would sit on the stove. And then if you had a barn burner or something at night and you needed a little pick-me-up, in between, you know, getting the rig ready and a shower, there was your hot soup. Well, Shine brought in a hot soup, and we had it, and we shared it with everybody in house. And what happened? Everybody got together, and they were talking. They were talking about Shine in the fire service. Shine's got an old 49 Merc. He loves cars. The guy's an absolute gearhead. And he would talk about the car. And he talked about, he's a Marine. So he talked about high school and his dad being a fireman and his brother being a fireman and his grandfather being a fireman and how he joined the Marines. He was in there for some years and how he was one of the defenders of our freedom and what happened there afterwards and how he got into the fire service. And there was talk about things, general things, whether it was cars, life decisions, what happened when he was young, that you know, why he chose the Marines and then the fire service and what he got from his father and his brother. And he just has this story to tell. And we decided that, hey, let's do this soup thing. Well, we do it once a week. Sure enough, making a big whatever pot of chicken soup. And we sat down again. And people are at workstations or all over the place, milling around, and conversation starts again. And maybe it is about one of the shields. Maybe it's a big order about the shields. And we're talking about the shields, where they're going, that they're purchasing from us all the time for years. Because of the quality product, they keep coming back. And the relationship that they have with our customer service, They know them by names. You know, they're calling in and getting these orders in, and they're talking to each other by name because they know each other for a couple of years or years of service. And these soups brought in conversation, which was something different. You know, for lunches, people were going over here, and there was those groups of people. Well, we do this every Wednesday, and it turned into a soup every Wednesday. And the majority of our roster is here on Wednesdays. I think we got full house every Wednesday. And that's when we did this soup thing. And it brought out more conversation. It could have been, I think Sue ended up getting a new car because we were talking about cars. She needed a new car, she bought a new car. A roofing problem was taken care of. Heating ventilation problem. There was one of the condensation and the drain lines from the AC was plugged and showed the, here, take off this cap, throw down the hanger, get whatever's gloopity gloopity inside there and goes out, and everything's going to start working again. And that's where that information came out. So it was a different family. And to say family, again, welcomed here with open arms. And there was great conversations to be had with these folks. Wow.
So, go ahead.
I was thinking about these soup days and the kitchen table at the firehouse. And it is unbelievable how those worlds collide because that was what I missed. I have that right now. And there's a lot of people here that can't wait for Wednesdays. It's not for a cup of soup. I don't think that really matters.
Yeah.
I think what they love is that connection that they have with people that they may have not had before. Just the stuff that we talk about is incredible.
As first responders, we all know the importance of continuous learning and development. Just like the best athletes or elite special forces, firefighters need to be at the top of their game, both physically and mentally. That's where Conway Shield Training Division comes in. They offer a wide range of training programs specifically designed for firefighters and other first responders. Whether you are looking to hone your rescue skills, master new equipment, or develop stronger leadership abilities, Conway Shield Training Division has something for you. Visit our training page, which is linked in the video description below. So I think, because we're running short on time, I think to sum that up, I think one of the things that Tim and Jim Schneider, Jimmy Shine, has brought from the firehouse into this office, there was always a sense of pride in everything these folks do downstairs and everybody in this building. I say downstairs, we have a two-story building. So there's been great pride in what they do here in this building since the creation of the company. But what these guys did is they took that camaraderie that you and I, you know, that you live or still live or that I used to live in the firehouse, and they brought all that in, and they started with soup. So in the wintertime, we have soups on a Wednesday, and then in the summertime, we cook, we have a full meal. We cook out. We do whatever we got to do to put food on the table for everybody in this building. But the key to it all is the camaraderie and the cohesiveness that is created in that even though people work together, they may not have known their families. They may not have known things about their lives, you know, and what they did is they brought all that together. And literally, when we break bread on a Wednesday, we basically shut the building down. We take a half hour, and I know if you're trying to call us, that's probably a time where you're thinking, what are they doing over there?
Those guys are eating
What
again.
Are they doing? But the reality is, that half hour we take every Wednesday out of our day, that we can sit together, all of us, everyone in this building sits together and communicates with each other, not only internal problems, external problems, stories of the firehouse, stories about the men and women that these people are making the equipment for that go out in the street and serve, stories that they understand that somewhere right now, somewhere in the United States, there is a man or a woman, there's a brother or sister that is either opening a roof, that is advancing a line,
that is searching above the fire for a victim, that are performing firefighting operations with a shield that came out of this office. And they take that to heart, and they take great pride in that. So with that, Tim, I applaud you for bringing that to the to this office, because I see how that has changed and how really the sense of community in this place, it's like a firehouse. I'm not kidding you. It is literally like a firehouse. And just the, everyone knows, I don't want to say everybody's business, but everybody actually genuinely cares for each other at a family level, because they have this half hour that they can use to not do work, but to actually talk about their lives, their issues, their concerns, and bring them forward to the table with a group that's willing to listen and help them out if possible. So as a takeaway, I would say that wherever you are in your community, whether it be your home, whether it be the firehouse, whether it be your side job, whether it be whatever, remember, let's develop this sense of community and actually care about each other as a family. Because I'm not saying we're always going to like each other. I'm not saying we're always going to agree with what the plan is. But the reality is, when we treat each other as family and we treat each other with compassion and we expect to be treated as we would want to be treated, anything else, the roadblocks, they're bumps in the street, they're not roadblocks. So let's think of that as a takeaway. But Tim, let's leave on a very high note today, and I need you to just give me an idea of what you see in everyone in this building, in the fact of this is not a job. They hold the line when they say, when this company says we protect courage, they live it every single day. And just, let's fade out with the idea of the pride that's in this building, that not only you carry in your heart, but that everybody in here carries, that it's not, they're just not coming to work. They're not showing up, punching a time clock and going home. They actually live this life of servitude in this building.
When you say pride, that's what, you know, I see it when I walk in the door, because there are some that start at 6 a.m. They're here already sewing away or doing whatever they need to do. And the pride that is displayed here every day, wow. It absolutely warms my heart, especially when they know where these shields are going. When all the folks are working together, and we have a good flow going through here, and shields are going out the door, we know that they're going to somebody out there that represents something that's bigger than them. Having a shield on their helmet, you know, and writing that new story and the next chapter and the next assignment, and we're fortunate to have their business, and we know where this leather is going. The folks here know about it, whether it's I never want to see a line of duty death ever, but to see when I have to tell them that there was a line of duty death, and to see the entire team come together and, to see what they do when we're like, we need to get this out. And normally contacting us is the last thing that people remember about a past firefighter. And they have the funeral planned, and the one thing that they finally remember is that shield. That shield means something to them. And so the family will reach out, and we are going to rush it there, whether it's a plaque, shield, whatever. Seeing the company all come, customer service from the phone call down into manufacturing, to see the pep in their step, and how to, everybody is motivated to make sure that this shield is, normally we will get it and have it done same day and overnight it to somebody. Seeing that and how important that is to them, if this was just a company that glues leather and sews and puts it in an envelope and ships, well, this ain't it. The family concept is here. The pride is here for sure. And, wow, I look back at, we just had a line of duty, and that's exactly what happened. The family forgot about it. And this was going to Missouri. Assistant Chief just passed on this past Wednesday or Monday. And we got those shields out, and to see everybody work as quick as they possibly can, and they were gold leaf. So we had graphic arts, the gold leaf applications, all the leather put together, grinding, riveting, bracketing, and then shipping. And that was all of about an hour and a half before we got it and overnighted those shields. And it's very impressive that the folks here just don't consider this, you know, this isn't 9 to 5. There's all different hours of the week. There should be a big sign, pride, because we see it every day that we walk through the door. It is absolutely amazing. These folks have such a skill set and are driven by, doing the best job that they can, and they are talented. And it's nice to see every time a shield goes out, how many hands have actually touched it. You know, we have 13 people in manufacturing. We have four in, I call it our arts and crafts division.
That'd be graphics to the rest of us, graphics, but they call it arts and crafts.
Yeah, it's, and the pride that is displayed, absolutely warms my heart.
Second to none. So with that, we're going to start wrapping down here. We're actually over time, but I over schedule, but I really did wanted you to let people understand what goes on, get a little idea what goes on in this building. You know, every one of your shields is important to us. And I understand that. You know, I was a young firefighter, and I had those chapters changing in my career, and then I was promoted. And we all know that when that happens, I'll use myself as an example, and I think Timmy would agree, that when that happens, we want that stuff that says we're lieutenant or we're a captain or we're a battalion chief. We want that yesterday because we're so proud of gaining that position. We're so proud of going to that new company. We're so proud of doing those things that we want it all right now. And understand that the people here in this building are proud to make that product for you. But give you an idea, roughly, how many shields we put out the door on an average day?
Average, I wouldn't say there's an average, but it can go anywhere from 200 to about 1,000. But planning at the beginning of the week, oh my gosh, the plan goes for thousands of shields that have to go out the door.
So we're literally, you know, we're moving thousands of shields. 13 people are pushing thousands of shields out the door. So we understand that shield is your shield, and it's the only shield you really care about. But they're doing their best every single day with the workmanship, the quality, the pride to understand that they are protecting courage. They are making a difference. And they are happy to do it, and they're proud to do it. So just understand that sometimes, whether it be a customer service rep that you don't maybe like or whatever it is, again, all I ask as the person who founded this company 40 years ago is to treat each other as we expect to be treated, because they really have your best interest at heart here. From Tim, who does the production every single day and lays the line out for the week to how we're going to get shields out the door, to our customer service reps, to our accounts people who do the payables, the receivables, all of it, to our sales folks, to everybody in this company. They believe in the statement, we protect courage. So with that, Tim, I thank you for being here today. It's really a pleasure. And I see you every single day, but we don't get a chance to talk too often because he is very busy. But I appreciate everybody listening. If you liked what you heard today, I ask that you hit the like button and that you subscribe to our channel. And I hope that this gave you a little bit of an opportunity, insight into what goes on at Conway Shield, where, again, we protect courage. From all of us at Beyond the Shield, have a wonderful day. God bless.